In the next few videos, we're going to cover vision. This video is going to start by going over the structure and function of the eye. To begin, you can take a look at this diagram of the eye. We're going to start with the sclera, which is the protective outer layer of the eye. You can see that the sclera covers the entire eye except the part in the front, which is the cornea. The cornea is actually continuous with the sclera, except the cornea is a transparent structure, and it covers the iris, pupil, and anterior chamber. Because the cornea is transparent, it allows light to pass through it, and once it passes through the cornea, the light will reach the anterior chamber. As you can see in the diagram, the anterior chamber is a compartment between the cornea and the iris, and it's also filled with a fluid called aqueous humor. From the anterior chamber, the light is going to continue through the pupil. The pupil, as you can see in the diagram, is a hole, and the size of this hole, the pupil, is controlled by the iris. The iris is a pigmented structure, and its ability to control the pupil size is actually really important. So as examples, you can consider if you go outside and it's a very bright day, your pupils are going to constrict, and that's to reduce the amount of light that enters your eyes. And that's because if too much light enters your eye, you'll be blinded by all the light. The opposite is when you're in a dark environment. Your pupils will actually become dilated to let in as much light as possible so you can better see in the dark. All right, so light passes through the cornea, it goes through the anterior chamber, it passes through the pupil, and from there it's going to reach the posterior chamber. The posterior chamber is the compartment between the iris and the lens, and it's also filled with aqueous humor. The light will then reach the lens. As you can see in the diagram, the lens is a transparent structure, and it has an important role in focusing light onto the retina. When you think about the term lens, you might recall some of the concepts you've learned in physics. And it's actually important for you to know that our eyes actually have two physics lenses. As it turns out, both the cornea and the lens are converging lenses. And it's converging lenses, they're able to help focus light onto our retina. The interesting thing is that between the cornea and the lens, the cornea actually has more optical power than the lens. So you might wonder, why do we call the lens if it's weaker than the cornea? A major reason is because the lens is attached to a structure called the ciliary body. If you take a look again at the diagram, you'll see that the ciliary body is a muscular structure, and it actually controls the shape of the lens. This is what we call accommodation. When the ciliary muscles contract, they actually change the shape of the lens in such a way to allow you to better focus on close objects. We can do a quick demonstration. If you put your two fingers in front of you, one finger close to your face and one finger far away, you can start first by focusing on the finger far away, and what you'll notice is the finger close to you has become blurry. If you then focus on the finger close to your face, you'll notice that the finger that is far away has become blurry. This is evidence that your ciliary body is functioning properly to allow you to focus on farther objects or closer objects by changing the shape of your lens. The unfortunate news is that this accommodation actually goes away as you age. So what you notice is a lot of elderly people, when they're trying to read text, if the text is small, they're not going to bring it close to their face. They actually hold it far away, and that's because they've lost the ability to change the shape of their lens to focus on objects that are close to them. Okay, so next we have the vitreous chamber. As you can see from the diagram, the vitreous chamber is the compartment between the lens and the retina, and it's filled with a fluid called vitreous humor. Light is going to pass through the vitreous humor and reach the retina. You can see in the diagram that the retina is the back part of the eye, and it's a light-sensitive tissue that is responsible for converting photons of light into an electrical neural signal that is sent to the brain. And it's able to do this because the retina contains photoreceptors, rods, and cones. The retina, because it's sending neural signals to the brain, it has to use axons, and those axons have to leave the eye to get to the brain. The bundle of axons that leave the retina and go to the brain is called the optic nerve, and the part of the eye where they exit is called the optic disc. If you look again at the diagram, you'll see that the optic disc is where that optic nerve exits the eye, and that part of the eye does not have any photoreceptors. So because of that, the optic disc also corresponds to the blind spot of each eye. What that means is there is a spot in each of our eyes that is not able to see anything. And usually we don't notice this at all because our brain essentially just makes our vision continuous, but the blind spot is real and does exist. All right, and finally we have the fovea. If you look at the diagram, you'll see that the fovea is a particular area of the retina. The fovea is important because it has a high density of cone and the highest acuity vision. So anywhere you look, really right at the center of your focus, that's where you have the highest visual acuity, and that's due to the fovea. All right, so to summarize, the path of light, it begins by passing through the cornea. It enters the anterior chamber, it passes through the pupil, it continues through the posterior chamber, it is focused by the lens, it passes through the vitreous chamber, and it reaches your retina that then converts the light into a neural signal.
If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing to our YouTube channel and clicking the bell icon for notifications. We release new videos every week covering the highest yield content on the MCAT. Plus, you can check out the video description for links to useful resources like our MCAT Prep mobile application.